Hello, my dear students. I hope all of you are keeping safe and staying at home. Due to the present situation, we cannot continue our regular classes in college. But as we have to continue our studies, I know this one-sided lecture won't be as effective as the classes we used to have. But still, let's take recourse to this medium to continue our studies and to finish our syllabus. So today I would be talking about The Way of the World by William Congreve. As you all know, this is a part of your CC8 paper, 18th Century British Literature. And we had a few classes on this before this lockdown started. So let's have a quick flashback of what we studied in the classes before moving further. So we discussed about the Restoration period, the social context of the Restoration period, and what is Restoration comedy. And we have elaborately discussed about Restoration comedy of manners, the features of Restoration comedy, and the criticism of the same. So I hope you all are aware of the features and the criticism and the social context of Restoration comedy of manners. So today we would discuss specifically about the features of Congreve's plays and what were the characteristics of Congreve's writing, and I would try to summarize the plot of The Way of the World in short. I would be dividing this lecture into two parts. In the first part, I would be talking about the life and literary career of William Congreve and his writing style. And in the second part, I would be discussing the plot of the play, The Way of the World. So, William Congreve was born 10 years after the restoration of Charles II to the throne of England, that was in the year 1660. So Congreve was born in the year 1670. Not much is known about Congreve's early life and his childhood. His father was Colonel William Congreve and his mother was Mary Browning. Congreve was educated at Kilkenny College, where he befriended Jonathan Swift, and later on he studied at the Trinity College in Dublin. He moved to London to study law at the Middle Temple, but he always preferred literature and drama. He entered the world of literature in a very early age. At the age of 17, he published his first piece of literature, which was a novel entitled Incognita, or Love and Duty Reconciled. Congreve used the pseudonym Cleophile to publish this novel. This was praised by John Dryden, whom he befriended at a literary circle at Will's Coffee House. Dryden supported Congreve throughout his life. Although Congreve started his literary career with a novel, the design of the novel was indicating that he was going to be a dramatist in future. There were more dialogues than descriptions in the novel, and he used disguise, masks, mistaken identities, which later became a signature part of his plays. Congreve was more concerned, or he was more preoccupied with the sound of the words rather than their implication. So all these traits somewhere signified, or they were indicating towards Congreve as a dramatist. Congreve's first comedy, The Old Bachelor, was composed during 1691 and 92. It was first staged on the 16th of January 1693 by the Royal Theatre. The Old Bachelor was a roaring success. The wit and humor of Congreve's writing was praised by stalwarts like Dryden. He said he never saw such a first play in his life. The stuff which was rich indeed, it wanted only the fashionable cut of the town. So with his first play, Congreve became a familiar figure in the literary circle of the Restoration period. His next comedy was The Double Dealer, which was performed at the Royal Theatre in October 1693. Initially, it was not as successful as The Old Bachelor. Even if it was not as successful as The Old Bachelor, Congreve was very much gratified to find that it won the appreciation of Dryden, Jonathan Swift, and Queen Mary herself. In the meantime, William Congreve and a few other actors of the Royal Theatre had a difference of opinion with the proprietors of the Royal Theatre, and they rebelled against them and organized a new theatrical company named Lincoln's Inn Theatre, which was built in the tennis court at Lincoln's Inn Fields with the help of liberal subsidies from many prominent people. Congreve's next comedy, Love for Love, inaugurated the new theatre, Lincoln's Inn Theatre, on 10th April 1695. This play was a huge success for Congreve. After the production of Love for Love, Congreve became one of the managers of the Lincoln's Inn Fields in 1695. During this period, he wrote his Essay on Humor in Comedy, where he defined his sense of humor. He said, "I take it to be a singular and unavoidable manner of doing or saying anything peculiar and natural to one man only, by which his speech and actions are distinguished from other men." So this was Congreve's idea of what humor is. During this time, other than writing these essays, he also wrote a few occasional verses, which include a prologue to a play written by Dryden's younger son. While these were the byproducts of Congreve's literary activity, his principal preoccupation was drama. During this time, he was working on a tragedy entitled The Mourning Bride. It was enacted in the year 1697. This play established Congreve as a versatile dramatist, equally equipped in writing tragedy. Then comes Congreve's next and final play, which would be the focal point of our discussion, The Way of the World. It was produced at the Lincoln's Inn Fields in March 1700. During Congreve's lifetime, four variations of this text were published by Congreve's friend Jacob Tonson. The first and second editions, referred to as Quarto 1 or Q1 and Quarto 2 or Q2, appeared in the years 1700 and 1706 respectively. There were not much changes in these two editions. In 1710, Tonson published the works of Mr. William Congreve, which is also referred to as W1. And then he published a second edition of this same text in the year 1719 and 20. Congreve made some significant changes in the later editions, which are W1 and W2, and specifically these changes were in the arrangement of the scenes. In the Q1 and Q2 editions, the scenes changed only when the setting changed. Each act has one setting. Act 1 is set in a chocolate house. Act 2 is set in St. James Park. Act 3, 4 and 5 are in a room in Lady Wishfort's house. The two quarto editions have only one scene to each act. However, in the W1 edition, which was published in the year 1710, a new scene begins every time a new character enters or leaves the stage. And according to this rule, Acts 1 and 2 have 9 scenes, Act 3 has 18 scenes, Act 4 has 15 scenes, and Act 5 has 14 scenes. Although it might be a bit confusing for us to read, but Congreve intended this play to be like this. And if we look into this tradition closely, we would find similarity with that of Ben Jonson and his contemporary French dramatists. We would talk about this tradition of Congreve and the intricate details of it when we would be discussing the text in details. So this was Congreve's last and final play. After this, he took retirement from the stage. After The Way of the World, Congreve did not produce any significant piece of literature in his lifetime. He died in the year 1729. So this was a brief idea of Congreve's life history, and now we would talk about Congreve's writing style and the art of writing. Congreve's prose style was preeminently that of a comic dramatist. His words are carefully chosen, his sentences are perfectly constructed, and his repartees or witty statements are balanced with one another. He used words according to their sound value. His preoccupation with the sound value of words is evident in many unusual but successful and satisfying combination of words. And the dialogues often assumes vigor, compactness, and a deceptive naturalness which made a prolonged effect on the mind of the audience. His dialogues were intended to be spoken with immediate effectiveness. He never overburdened them with emotions and expressions. He made a perfect use of certain rhetorical devices as onomatopoeia, alliteration, and antithesis, and if required, he made a repeated use of these rhetorical devices, and he also made repetition of a particular word in order to create a magical effect. Wit and humor and a sense of satire is omnipresent in all the writing of Congreve. The witty dialogues of his characters and an undertone of satire is always there in every play of Congreve. Millamant's witty repartees when she appeared on first time on the stage, or Lady Wishfort's meticulous choice of language, are marvelously presented by Congreve in each and every dialogue that we read. His plays are a rich orchestration of varying types of witty dialogues, humorous ideas, and a satirical tone which we can experience in all of his writings. Now, let's talk about Congreve's art of plot construction and the specific tools which he used to create his signature mark in the domain of Restoration Comedy of Manners. So Congreve's made use of certain design and contextures in order to create the complexity of his plot. He made an extensive use of disguise, masks, mistaken identity, false names, false marriages, misrepresentations, intrigues to increase the complex nature of his plot. Music was a very essential part of Congreve's art. As Congreve used to divide his scenes with the entry and exit of each character, he conceived every single scene as a span of music and the dialogues of different characters as the many speeches contributing to a rich orchestration of the play. The whole play indeed is like a superb orchestration, the tempo varying incessantly, the diverse notes being subtly adapted to the underlying purpose in terms of characters and situation. Another important aspect of Congreve's plot construction was his rigidity about the three unities to be followed while writing a play. So, and especially he focused on the unities of place and time. Generally, the scenes of his plays were set in a house or a park. And in terms of time, the time is just equal to that of the presentation of the play on the stage. Other than this, Congreve also excelled in the portrayal of women in his plays, and he produced a pleasing variety of women of the Restoration time. It was kind of an unsaid rule of his plays that he would bring his heroines on stage only in the second act after adequately creating a curiosity about them. In The Way of the World, Millamant is described from various angles by several of the other characters in the first act of the play. We know how her beauty and vivacity and adorable womanliness have cast a spell on the world of man. We know how Mirabel loves her. We know how she laughs at Petulant, and she is described by Whitwood as a woman and a kind of humorist. So all these descriptions about Millamant has created a high expectation in the mind of the audience, and when she appears in the next act, she does not disappoint them. Thus, Congreve was an artist who, with a few carefully chosen words, could create a character and make it live. His characters are involved in various actions and as a matter of course, but they reveal themselves best in their speeches. And this brings to us that how Congreve as a creator makes his characters alive through their speeches. So this was, in short, a discussion about Congreve's art of creating plot and his style of writing. Now, let us come to the second part of this lecture, where I would give you a brief summary of the plot of the drama The Way of the World. Before going to the plot directly, let's discuss the characters. As you can see on your screen, that there's a list of male characters and another list of female characters. So let's start with the male characters. We have Fainall, who is in love with Mrs. Marwood. Then we have Mirabel, the central character or the protagonist of the play, who is in love with the heroine, Mrs. Millamant. Then there are two male characters, Witwoud and Petulant, who are followers or admirers of Mrs. Millamant. Then there is Sir Wilful Witwoud, who is a half-brother to Witwoud and nephew to Lady Wishfort. And we have Waitwell, who is the servant of Mirabel. Now, let's come to the female characters. So, we have the most important character, Lady Wishfort, who is enemy to Mirabel. There are reasons for that, which we would discuss in the plot. And the main reason of her enmity with Mirabel is because he has falsely pretended to love her. Then there's the heroine of the play, Mrs. Millamant, who is a fine lady, who is Lady Wishfort's niece and who loves Mirabel. Then we have Mrs. Marwood, who is Mr. Fainall's friend and she likes Mirabel. Then there is Mrs. Fainall, who is Lady Wishfort's daughter, Mr. Fainall's wife and formerly friend to Mirabel. We have Foible, who is the woman to Lady Wishfort, who waits at Lady Wishfort. Then we have Mincing, who is a woman to Mrs. Millamant. There is Betty, who is a waiting woman at the chocolate house. And we have Peg, who is waiting woman to Lady Wishfort. Now, let's understand the relationship between the characters first before discussing the plot in details. As we have discussed in the style of Congreve, that it was his signature mark to use misrepresentations, intrigues, false names in order to make the plot more complex, it is necessary to understand the relationship of the characters before going to the plot. So let's start with Lady Wishfort and her relationship with the other characters of the play. So, Lady Wishfort is a widow who had two sisters. Both of them are dead. So, one of those sisters was the mother of Millamant, the heroine of this play. And it is willed that Millamant would receive only half of her inheritance if she marries without her aunt's, that is Lady Wishfort's, consent. So naturally, it is very important for Millamant to get her aunt's approval of her marriage in order to inherit her full fortune. And from here, the complication begins. Millamant is in love with Mirabel, whom Lady Wishfort detests. There are reasons why Lady Wishfort does not like Mirabel. So, the most important reason is that Mirabel pretended to love Lady Wishfort and he courted Lady Wishfort in order to mask his relationship with Millamant. And Lady Wishfort came to know about this cheating of Mirabel from Mrs. Marwood, who is a friend of Lady Wishfort. So as she came to know that Mirabel cheated on her, and we have discussed how we have discussed the character, the characteristics of these women of the Restoration period, how they used to get into multiple relationships. So this was very much insulting to Lady Wishfort. So that is why she was very much angry with Mirabel, and Millamant knew it very well that Lady Wishfort would never agree to her marriage with Mirabel. Now, Lady Wishfort's another sister was the mother of Sir Wilful Witwoud. After her death, her husband married again and had a son, Anthony Witwoud, who is the half-brother of Sir Wilful Witwoud. And Lady Wishfort herself has a daughter, Mrs. Fainall, who first married someone called Langwish, who died, and after his death, she married Mr. Fainall. Next, we have the character of Mirabel, who is in love with Millamant. He previously had an affair with Mrs. Fainall, who is the daughter of Lady Wishfort. Then we have the character of Fainall, who is married to the daughter of Lady Wishfort, but he has an affair with Mrs. Marwood. Next, we have the character of Mrs. Marwood, who is friends to Lady Wishfort. She has an affair with Mr. Fainall, but she likes Mirabel. And we have Mrs. Fainall, who I have already said is the daughter of Lady Wishfort. She is the wife of Mr. Fainall, and she previously had an affair with Mirabel. So this was, in short, the interrelation of the characters, how the characters are related to each other. Now let's get into the plot of the play. The opening act of the play is concerned with the exposition of the plot. The central theme is a love story, the love relationship between Mirabel and Millamant, who wants to get married. And the problem begins with the consent of their marriage, which they need to attain from Lady Wishfort. We have already learned that Mirabel had falsely made love to Lady Wishfort in order to hide his relationship with Millamant. And ever since, Lady Wishfort has come to know about this deception from Mrs. Marwood, she is furious with Mirabel. But this is also important that unless Mirabel and Millamant marries with her consent, Millamant cannot claim her marriage portion, which is of 6,000 pounds. Other than Lady Wishfort, the lovers also have to deal with Mrs. Marwood and Fainall, both of whom are very much angry with Mirabel. They have their individual reasons. Mrs. Marwood dislikes Mirabel because he has ignored her love for him, and Mr. Fainall detests him because he thinks that his wife, Mrs. Fainall, is unfaithful to him, and the reason is her love for Mirabel. So these additional circumstances make it very much difficult for Mirabel and Millamant to make their love successful. From here, the plot is divided into two separate strands. The first one deals with Mirabel's ploy to attain Lady Wishfort's consent in his and Millamant's marriage. And the second one deals with the evil intentions of Mr. Fainall and Mrs. Marwood. So let's talk about the first one first, and then we would talk about the second. So Mirabel makes a plan with his servant Waitwell, Lady Wishfort's maid Foible, and Mrs. Fainall also helps him in this plan. So Lady Wishfort's maid Foible is married to Waitwell, who is Mirabel's servant. So the plan is, Waitwell is to disguise himself as Sir Roland, who is a fictitious uncle of Mirabel. And on the other hand, Foible is to tell Lady Wishfort that Sir Roland is deeply in love with her. As we know the characteristics of Restoration women who are always interested in love affairs, Lady Wishfort would be delighted to listen to this news, and she would immediately be interested to meet Sir Roland. Then the plan is like this, that Sir Roland and Lady Wishfort would meet, and
they would eventually marry, and after that Mirabel would get into the scene and he would reveal the real identity of Sir Roland, and that Lady Wishfort is caught in a false marriage, and as she would be very much anxious to save her reputation, she would give consent to Millamant and Mirabel's marriage on the return of her, the annulment of her marriage to Sir Roland, who is actually Waitwell, Mirabel's servant. But this plan fails as Mrs. Marwood intervenes and she overhears a conversation between Foible and Mrs. Fainall, and she comes to know about this plan of Mirabel and she reveals it to Lady Wishfort. Now, let's come to the second strand of the plot, which involves the evil intentions of Mr. Fainall and Mrs. Marwood, who wants to discredit Mrs. Fainall in front of Lady Wishfort, and their aim is Lady Wishfort's property. In the meantime, Mrs. Fainall collects evidence of Mr. Fainall and Mrs. Marwood's relationship from Foible, and she reveals it to her mother, Lady Wishfort, thus countering her husband's scheme. So now Mr. Fainall's spiteful face is revealed to everybody, and he makes his final blow by demanding his wife's property, but here Mirabel comes as the savior. With the help of the black box brought in by Waitwell, Mirabel reveals that the entire estate of Mrs. Fainall is entrusted to Mirabel even before she was married to Mr. Fainall, so he cannot claim any property of Mrs. Fainall or Lady Wishfort. After this, all the problems are resolved. Mirabel apologizes to Lady Wishfort, and Lady Wishfort gives consent to the marriage of Mirabel and Millamant. So now we have a happy ending. Everybody is happy, all the problems resolved. Only Mr. Fainall leaves in anger. I hope now you have a clear idea about Congreve's literary career and his writing style and the plot of the play, The Way of the World. If you have any query regarding this lecture, please contact me. Thank you.